السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر. الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن لا أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وأطهر المرسلين، شفيع المذنبين وحبيب رب العالمين محمد صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين. إن الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful, all praise is due to Allah. We bear witness that no one is worthy of worship but Allah. And we bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is indeed his final messenger. The best of speech is the book of Allah, and the best of guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who listen to the best of speech, the book of Allah, and adhere to its commandments. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who come to know the best of ways, the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and make us amongst his followers. يا أحباب رسول الله صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه، يدعونا ربنا جل وعلا إلى التفكر في أنفسنا قائلا وفي أنفسكم أفلا تبصرون. One of the ways that the Quran gets us to know our creator better, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and as you know, brothers and sisters in Islam, it is not enough to just believe in the existence of Allah. Rather, believe in the existence of Allah And you get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not just to know Him, but rather to have a very personal relationship with Him that ought to impact our lives positively. So it says to get to know Allah and develop a very personal relationship with Him. And the Quran does this in one of two ways. Where Allah tells us about Himself so that we get to know Him personally better. And then also Allah tells us about what He has created. And many times you can learn about Allah through what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. Or as they so beautifully put it, قَالُوا نَتَعَرَّفُ عَلَى اللَّهِ عَنْ طَرِيقِ الْكِتَابِ الْمَسْطُورِ وَالْكَوْنِ الْمَنْظُورِ We get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His creation and through His revelation. And the better we know our Creator, we are taught, and we observe, the stronger our relationship is with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. لذلك قالوا أقرب الناس إلى الله أعرف الناس بالله. Those who are closest to Allah are those who know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala best. So in one of these invitations that the Quran extends to us, we are invited, وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ And in your own selves, in your own creation, would you not see the marvelous creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And today, just very quickly, inshallah, take you through a trip in one of the marvelous creations within us human beings. And to make this as relevant as possible, this last Saturday, the 24th of Saturday, the news came out that there has been mass murder in Santa Barbara. Where there was this young man, Elliot Roger, I believe his name was, about 22 years old, goes out on a shooting spree, where he kills two of his roommates, stabbing them to death, and a third visitor. Then he goes out to Santa Barbara, UC Santa Barbara, and he starts shooting people, totally 13 people, of which 3 people are dead, killing a total of 6 people, before turning the gun on himself, and we have 7 dead people. And as we say, subhanallah, because just a year and a half ago, another incident took place where somebody goes to an elementary school and then they start shooting people. And we as parents who have children, you know that the school comes a place where we trust that our children are in good hands. The last thing that you want as a parent is a phone call from the school. You know what? Sometimes we can tolerate your son, your daughter is not feeling well. Come and pick them up. We do so. Alhamdulillah, they're well. Can you imagine being told that there's been a shooting in your son's or daughter's school? And there are many people who have been shot and many people are dead. And subhanAllah, can you just imagine what is going on with these parents? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them lots and lots of patience, Ya Rabbal Alameen. So you look into this and say, what was happening to this young man? Why did he do this? And we are told that the man, this young boy, was mentally disturbed. In fact, he has been mentally disturbed since the age of 8. He's been seeing therapists and he's been psychiatrists and he's been on medication, and May happens also to be Mental Health Awareness Month. And we have a tendency, brothers and sisters, that when it comes to mental health, when it comes to the lack of health disorders, you know, as a society, especially in our community, there is a stigma and there is a taboo talking about mental health related issues. Wallahi, if I ask right now, how many of you are diabetic? Many of us wouldn't really have a problem putting our hands up. You know, I'm diabetic, no problem. Anybody having high cholesterol? Many people would put their hands up, high cholesterol. Anybody taking this medication? People would do that. If you ask, anybody here depressed? Anybody here taking medication for anxiety? Very few of us are going to honestly raise their hands. Because we believe that some diseases are better than others. And some kind of sickness are better than others. And some kind of patients are better than others. And usually, any mental health related issue, that is not good. You just don't raise your hand or you talk about it. And subhanAllah, when you look into this brain that we have, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invites us just think about the beauty of the creation of Allah. And when you look into this brain that we have, subhanAllah, one of the most amazing organs, not in our body, but rather in the whole planet Earth, the most complex system that we as human beings know at this point, subhanAllah, is the brain. In command of the central nervous system. Listen to this. It is in command of the central nervous system, yet the brain does not have nerves. It is in command of the central nervous system, yet the brain does not have nerves. It regulates the nerves, but it does not have nerves. In other words, say that the brain cannot really feel the pain. We're told that the amount of neurons within the brain are about 100 billion of them. Making it, subhanAllah, amazingly, unbelievably beautiful and complex and complicated. 100 billion, that is 15 times the total population of the earth. We're talking about, subhanAllah, as the child, the baby, is being developing in the mother's womb, the brain is developing at the rate of 250,000 neurons per minute. Wallahi, that is amazing. It is unbelievable, subhanAllah. Yet 60% of it is fat. It only is equivalent to 2% of our total weight, yet it consumes 20% of the energy that is produced by the body. Over 60% of the cardiac output, is actually designated to the brain. I have, subhanAllah, just one marvelous organ that we take and we walk around with. And when you look, subhanAllah, in just the amount of energy that is needed to keep the brain functioning, 25 watts, they say that this is enough to light a light bulb. That is like how much energy is being put there. When you look into the functions of the brain, amazing seven functions. Processing information, motivation, arousal, perception, memory, homeostasis, meaning that it regulates our internal environment. And then on top of that, learning and subhanAllah, and learning and memory. In other words, it is said that the way that we acquire language and so on, subhanAllah, just really, really an amazing organ. And that is why, my brothers and sisters, we say that there are actually two functions to the brain. There is the physical function to the brain, and that is regulating all these functions that we spoke about. That is the physical component of it. But then there is also the psychological and emotional component of our brain. And that is where our emotions come in. Our perception comes in. The whole notion of us feeling mentally healthy comes in. And this part, brothers and sisters, is not just done automatically. This is something that we actually take an active part in achieving this. SubhanAllah, just reading statistics about what is going on, I was just astonished to learn that the leading cause of disability in the world, listen to this, the leading cause of disability in the world is not car accidents, is not diabetes, it is not heart problems, but rather they say that the number one cause of disability in the world is depression. Number five is alcohol addiction. So in the five main factors leading to disability in the world, two of them have to do with our psychological and emotional well-being. Yet as a society, we are very afraid of talking about this issue and addressing this issue. But subhanAllah again, and we keep saying this, that the whole purpose of having a khutbah, having a community, is for the people to come together so that we address issues that are of importance to us. Brothers and sisters, the leading cause of death amongst people between the ages of 18 and 25 is not car accidents, it is suicide. Can you imagine this?
the leading cause of people between the ages of 18 and 25, you think that it's car accidents, crazy teenagers driving crazy? Man, that is not the case. It is actually suicide. Did you know that there is a person committing suicide here in the US every 15 minutes? That is 90 people a day. Throughout the world, suicide is the 11th leading cause of death in the world. So when you have something that is this big, it is definitely worthy of our attention and that we speak about it. And we dispel all these myths about mental health issues or mental disorders so that we speak our deen and so that we speak for the benefit of our brothers and sisters. Please, inshallah, move forward to make room for those who are coming in. So we look into something like this and we say, we don't want to see many of this young man going around disturbing his life and the life of those who are around him and forever changing them. So that we want to address this. We want to extend information so that we are better informed, so that we can actually, subhanAllah, remember this, brothers and sisters. Difficult issues don't go away when we choose not to talk about them. Wallahi, they don't. We have a tendency to think that as long as we don't talk about it, you know what, things will be fine. Akhi, that is silly. Brother and sister, wallahi, that is silly. They only go away when we actually have the courage to deal with it and we actually address it. And that is why in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would just really tell us things that collectively we can say, man, that is a myth, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam never taught this. One common one is, anybody who has any mental issues, your iman is weak. Have you heard this one before? Oh man, I'm feeling depressed. Man, have you read the Quran lately? What does this have to do with what I just told you? That is guilting people into becoming religious. Yaqwan, wallahi, that is not how you approach religion. Oh, you know, I've been feeling down lately. Have you done your salah? Yeah, akhi, that has nothing to do with it. I'm not denying that being spiritual is important, but if I come to you and I say, yeah, brother, I am feeling down, I'm having anxiety, I'm having depression, the point is not to think that you know why I'm having this, and point me and say, man, you need to read more Quran and you need to do. Just listen to me. Sometimes, just listen to me. In fact, why don't we listen to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? ما أصاب المؤمن من هم ولا حزن ولا وصب. So that any time anxiety, depression, sadness, grief befalls on a believer. والشاهد قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم أصاب المؤمن. He said that meaning that as a believer, you really can go through this. And sometimes life throws challenges at us that can really bring us down. The death of a loved one. A marital relationship that is not going well. Concerned over your son or daughter. Concerned over your job, the lack of a job. Lack of money. SubhanAllah, it is natural that we go through this. So number one, brothers and sisters, please do not associate that somebody who is going through some sort of a mental disorder, automatically we assume that they must be insufficient or deficient in their level of religiosity. That is not the case. And please also remember, we're not necessarily saying the opposite. We're saying, subhanAllah, the better relationship we have with our Creator, it is supposed to impact our attitude more positively. So what are we saying? We are saying that religion does not inherently, automatically protect us against mental issues. Please listen to this. Religion does not automatically grant us immunity against mental health disorders. Because I am religious, I should never suffer this. Come on, man. It does not work out this way. So, well, what does religion do? Religion gives us enough tools that when we are down, we do not go into despair. يَا بَنِيَ اذْهَبُوا فَتَحَسَّسُوا مِنْ يُوسُفَ وَأَخِيهِ وَلَا تَيْأَسُوا مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْكَافِرُونَ. صلوا على رسول الله. Ya'qub alayhi salam is telling us about this, the idea of getting to the point of yes, despair, absolute lack of any hope, he said that is not befitting to a believer. At that point, I can question your level of religiosity. But we say that because you are religious, it does not mean that you are inherently protected against these types of issues. We will all go through it. And that is just part of us being human beings. So when we find out something like this, we as believers, we say, SubhanAllah, you know what? It seems like that part of my brain is not really doing well. Physically, it may be going well, but SubhanAllah, they say emotionally, we're not doing well. You know what I also learned that was SubhanAllah absolutely mind-boggling? That 50% of mental health medication is actually not given out by psychiatrists. It is actually given out by primary doctors. And so what happens is that these people go because they are so afraid of going to a psychiatrist because that's just something terrible. So they go to their primary doctor and they have all these kind of complaints. And the sad part is they say that the average amount of time that the primary doctor spends with the patient is 7 minutes. You know, for those of us who have gone to the doctor, you actually do more waiting in the waiting room than you do in seeing the doctor himself. 7 minutes. And the doctor comes in and they see you and they look into the chart and they say, no, you're not feeling well. So it's these doctors that are given the medications and not really the psychiatrists out there, because we have stigmatized such a thing. But then when you look into the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, people will be at the masjid. Love that hadith. When Ibn Umar was sitting in the masjid and he was in the state of i'tikaf, seclusion, you know, having his private own time with Allah, he was the guest of Allah in the masjid. Something that is just very virtuous. Somebody walks in and the hadith said that, and his facial expressions, they gave away a great deal of anxiety. You know, SubhanAllah, what that tells us? That people are honest with their emotions. See, many times, we are not. We are not honest with our emotions. So usually what happens to us is that we suffer in silence. We suffer in silence. You see people and they're smiling and they're going about and mashallah, appreciate the resilience. But is that really resilience? Or are we just really lying to ourselves and to those who are around us? But subhanAllah, when people are not afraid and they feel welcome, the man came to the masjid and his facial expressions gave away what was happening with him. Ibn Umar sees this and he does what every responsible believer does. He goes up to them and goes, what happened? You know, I see that you're very concerned and what is going on with you? And the man looks down and with a great deal of anxiety said, man, I am overwhelmed by debts. Can we say that that man was not a believer? The man is coming to the masjid. He has nowhere else to go. He comes to the masjid and said, I'm just overwhelmed by debts, man. And today is the due date, and I have absolutely nothing to give. I cannot pay back. So I said, I am in this state of anxiety and depression that you see me. So Ibn Umar makes an offer. Said, brother, would you like me to go to the person that lent you the money and speak on your behalf, advocate for you? And the man said, I'll be so grateful if you do this. You know why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught, مَن نَفَّسَ عَن مُؤْمِنٍ كُرْبَةً مِن كُرَبِ الدُّنْيَا نَفَّسَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ كُرْبَةً مِن كُرَبِ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ وَمَن فَرَّجَ عَن مُؤْمِنٍ كُرْبَةً مِن كُرَبِ الدُّنْيَا فَرَّجَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كُرْبَةً مِن كُرَبِ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ صَلَّى عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. The hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you know, whosoever helps a believer in eliminating their calamity or in reducing the amount of anxiety that this person is going through, said that Allah will treat you the same on the day of judgment, and that is when we need to truly be liberated from the calamities of that day. So do so in this world and Allah will do the same to you. So Ibn Umar said, let's go, I am coming with you. Now the people who are in the masjid said, oh Ibn Umar, you forgot, man. Remember you have come to the masjid because you decided to do i'tikaf, seclusion, and having your private time with Allah. And then Ibn Umar said, uskut. Said, be quiet. Be quiet, he said. فَوَاللَّهِ إِنِّي سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ لَأَنْ يَمْشِيَ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي حَاجَةِ أَخِيهِ خَيْرٌ لَهُ مِنْ أَنْ يَعْتَكِفَ عَشْرَ سِنِينَ. He said, man, be quiet. I heard the Messenger of Allah teach, he said, to walk with your brother, to get something done for him is better for you than staying in the masjid for 10 consecutive years. What is going on? It's a community that cares. It's a community that truly wants to alleviate the pain of the members of the community. So we say, as a community, we are not afraid of addressing this issue. And not only that, but Islam really wants us to be in the best of mental health. And that is our ability to enjoy the good that life offers us, and also our ability to face the challenges that life throws our way. If we are able to do this, then we say we are mentally healthy. Our ability to enjoy and our ability to face. When we have this, we can say, Alhamdulillah, we are in the state of well-being. And that's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالْخَيْرِ وَالشَّرِّ فِتْنَةً. We shall test you by times of ease and times of difficulty as a form of trial. So what do you do in the times of ease? You enjoy. And what do you do in times of difficulty? You face the difficulty. Once this happens, we can say, Alhamdulillah, we are in the state of equilibrium, or we are in the state of balance. And that makes us humans. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us that wisdom. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على رسوله المصطفى وعلى من بآثاره اقتفى. ابن حزم أبو محمد ابن حزم صاحب المحلى له كلمة جميلة يقول: إني تأملت في أحوال الناس من عرب ومن عجم، من فقير وغني، صغير وكبير، مسلم وكافر، نساء ورجال. ابن حزم has a beautiful statement. He said, I have pondered upon humans, he said, the young and the old, the poor and the rich, the Arabs and the non-Arabs, the Muslims and the non-Muslims, the young and the old, the men and the women. And he said, فَوَجَدْتُهُمْ قَدْ اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَمْرٍ وَاحِدٍ. He said, and it appeared to me, by means of my own observation, that all these people, regardless of how diverse they are, he said, I have seen that they all have one thing in common. فَإِنَّهُمْ قَدْ اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَىٰ دَفْعِ الْهَمِّ. Said, I see that what they have all in common is that they all try to repel to the best of their ability anxiety away from themselves. And then he said, وَلَمْ أَجِدُ أَحْسَنَ مِنْ دَفْعِ الْهَمِّ مِنَ التَّفَكُّرِ فِي أَمْرِ الْآخِرَةِ. اللهم اجعلنا من أهل الآخرة. He said that, and the best medicine that I have found that has really worked for me, he said, to repel above all these anxieties, he said, man, to ponder upon the day of judgment. He said, man, it just makes everything else seem insignificant. Not that he's being too simplistic or he's pushing away all these things, but rather he said, you know what, when you start worrying about little things, they really do suck the energy out of us. They take the beauty out of life. We will not be running on gas, but rather we will be exhausted and we will be running on fumes. Tired most of the time and out of energy. So he said, the more you pay attention to these little things, it will only deplete your energy. So he said, save that for something more significant. And all these little things will go away. May they all go away, Ya Rabbi Al-Alamin. We pray that for all the brothers and sisters who are not doing well, mentally speaking, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ease their pain. And if you have a family member, brothers and sisters, a loved one, a brother, a friend, please do not be afraid of talking to them. I'm reminded of this story when a young man said that, for whatever reason I came and I asked one of my friends, he said, I looked at them and I said, are you really happy? And that man said, never before a person asked me that question. Wallahi, if we ask right now, have we ever approached our friends, sometimes our own family members, and look at them and seriously say, are you happy? Man, we don't talk about this. We can talk about the NBA finals. We can talk about who's winning and who's losing. We can discuss politics. We can discuss local and internet. We will talk about anything and everything, but just don't go there, man. Don't go there. Are you serious? I can take you all the way there, but see, all the way there just becomes a shield because I don't want to talk about what is really happening with me. So let's make it easy for people to come and talk to us about these things. And sometimes it takes the initiative to say, are we really happy? And that, inshallah, becomes a door for us to help ourselves and others. On your behalf, I'd like to extend our sincere condolences to our brother Anis. His mother passed away yesterday in Oman, Sister Yusra Fakhouri. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless her soul, Ya Rabbul Alameen, and make her final abode paradise. Also, a young brother by the name of Yusuf Yahya was involved in a car accident, and unfortunately, he broke his spine, and he's undergoing operation, and he is in need of our dua. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him a speedy recovery, Ya Rabbul Alameen. In addition, inshallah, also remember our function, things that we do here locally. We do have the barbecue for the family. Please do come and join us. It's happening between Asr and Maghrib, and it's right across the street. Also, inshallah, our youth group, they're having a bonfire tonight at Doheny Beach at 7 p.m. And also, inshallah, this coming Wednesday, we will be starting a class. As you know, the month of Ramadan is only a month away, and it will be every Wednesday between Maghrib and Isha. And inshallah, it will be about the fiqh of fasting and zakah. So please, inshallah, do visit us. And finally, please do remember that Pillars Academy Summer Camp registration is open. اللهم يا رب فرج همنا وهم المكروبين ونفس كربنا وكرب المكروبين اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من الهم والحزن ونعوذ بك من العجز والكسل ونعوذ بك من البخل والجبن ونعوذ بك من غلبة الدين وقهر الرجال اللهم يا رب فرج هم المهمومين ونفس كرب المكروبين واقض الدين عن المدينين اللهم ارحم موتانا واشف مرضانا وفك أسرانا وعاف مبتلانا واختم الباقيات الصالحات آجالنا ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقم الصلاة